members and those around you, please turn off your flash. Video and audio recording are not permitted. There is no smoking allowed in the Ryman Auditorium at any time. Thank you for this consideration. We hope you enjoy the show.
In the snow, bless that happy day when Nellie lost her way. I found her when the snow was on the ground. Those happy hours we spent together forever in my heart and live. That's all I have for each tomorrow. That I don't love you. I'll just pretend that I don't care. And when I meet you face to face, dear, I turn my head. I'll just pretend. Try my best to forget you. To love you now is such a sin. And as I'm facing all my friends, dear, they'll understand. I won't pretend.
Mama don't allow no fiddle playing here. We don't care what your mama don't allow, we play her fiddle anyhow. Mama don't allow no fiddle playing here. Now mama don't allow no banjo picking here. Mama don't allow no banjo picking here. Earl don't care what mama don't allow, he'll pick his banjo anyhow. Mama don't allow no banjo picking here. Now mama don't allow no hound dog around here. Mama don't allow no hound dog around here.
We don't care what your mama don't allow, we play her hound dog anyhow. Mama don't allow no hound dog around here.
Oh boy, I didn't expect that. I'm here, I'm JT Scruggs. I'm one of Earl's nephews. I get to kick this off by welcoming you to celebrate what would have been Earl's 100th birthday. Everything that I hear and been told, you are in for a special treat tonight. I hope you're ready. Are you ready? All right. All right. Just a couple of things I'd like to do. First of all, Earl's grandson, Jess, and his granddaughter, Lindsay, Randy and Gary's children are here. I'd like to give them a big warm welcome, and Grace, my cousin. Now, quickly, Jerry told me I could do a quick commercial on the Earl Scruggs Center in Shelby, North Carolina. I hope if you have not been to the Scruggs Center, we would love for you to visit. We tried to tell the story of that region through Earl's eyes as he grew up and went on to basically cover the world and play across the world. And the second thing is Labor Day weekend, we have a Earl Scruggs Music Festival. If you haven't got your tickets, please do. We'd love to have you. It's a great festival. It's a partnership between the college, Isothermal Community College, the Earl Scruggs Center, and the Tryon Equestrian Center. It's a great facility. It's a great venue. You can come. You can eat. You can lodge. You can do everything there, and we'd love to have you. Now, here's my last thing, I promise. There's some people at work to put this together tonight, and I wanna welcome and recognize. One of them is Jerry's manager, Brian Pence, and let's give him a great big thank you. Folks, you don't really know how hard they work at this kind of stuff, and the next person, You may recognize him, I'm not 100% sure, but he worked pretty hard on this too. And he has been super. He's our host for the festival. He's been great for the Scruggs Center. And I want you to help me welcome Mr. Jerry Douglas.
Thank you, buddy.
Yes, sir.
JT Scruggs. Thank you. Thanks for showing up tonight, Nashville and North Carolina. I think the whole state is here tonight. It was great.
You know, we're here to celebrate the man, Earl Scruggs, on his 100th birthday. And, have a 100th birthday? Come on. Okay. Happy birthday, Earl. But, I was just talking with two of my closest friends in the whole world backstage, and we were talking, just really discussing it, and we've decided that not one of these musicians that you'll see tonight on this stage would be here if it wasn't for Earl Scruggs. Not one of them. Not one. I know I wouldn't be. And I don't know if the Ryman Auditorium would be here either if it wasn't for Flatt and Scruggs, you know, but they were a huge act, and they drew a lot of people, and the Opry loved them, and everything was great. We couldn't celebrate the man without acknowledging the woman beside him, Louise Scruggs. Yeah. And their sons, Gary, Randy, and Steve, who were all really good friends of mine. And I think we should be thinking about Lester Flatt tonight as well. So when my manager, Brian Penix, sidled up to me a little over two years ago, and said in a really low voice, "I just booked the Ryman Auditorium for Earl Scruggs' birthday." I think I went weak in the knees. And he said, I want you to, to create a show out of this. And so here I am, and here they are. it's my mind, when he said January the 6th, my mind landed on several things, you can imagine, at that point, and then none of which I need to remind you of. This is our chance to take back January the 6th. And remind the world what this really is. This is Earl Scruggs' birthday. You right? One other important message I have tonight is one of the greatest fiddle players to ever work with, Mr. Earl. Mr. Glenn Duncan was involved in a serious accident just the other night. And he needs all of our positive thoughts tonight. He's in rough shape, so please send them out to him, and we're going to miss him here tonight. We really wish Glenn was going to be here with us. So here we are. We all hope that you enjoy what we present to you tonight as much as we love delivering it to you. Welcome to all the Scruggs family here tonight. Jamie and Jesse, Gary's sons are here and their families. Miss Grace Constant, Mr. JT back here. And now I want to introduce you to Randy's daughter, Earl's granddaughter, Randy's daughter, Lindsay Scruggs. Would you bring Lindsay out? Hey, Lindsay. Let me stay with us.
Yeah, you can go. Hello. Welcome, everybody. Good to see you. 77 years. And 1 month ago, my grandparents, Louise and Earl Scruggs, or as I called them, Nana and Papa, met in the alley behind the Mother Church, or as you may call it, the Ryman Auditorium. Both came from nothing, but together, they forged a legacy. Flash forward to the 1950s, the music business was dominated by men. But that didn't stop Nana. In 1955, she took on the role of Papa's manager and booking agent, thusly becoming the first woman in the country music business to fill those shoes. I remember her telling a story about when Warren Beatty called regarding the usage of Foggy Mountain Breakdown in his upcoming film, Bonnie and Clyde. He asked to speak to Earl. Nana replied, "Well, you can talk to him, but you're still going to have to deal with me." Post-Flatt and Scruggs, the legacy expanded with my father, Randy, and my uncles, Gary and Steve, who brought their own expert musicianship to the Earl Scruggs Review, as well as countless other endeavors during their lifetimes. Today, this legacy continues with my cousin Chris, who in 2022 became the youngest musician ever to be inducted into the Musicians Hall of Fame. Now, before I hand over the stage to the professionals, I'd like to share an excerpt. So, this is actually my grandfather's day planner from 1974. Actually, it says cash account on it. I guess it isn't technically a day planner, but he jotted little notes in it. I have a couple of these, not many, but every once in a while I find something poignant in them. And I would like to share an excerpt from this, perhaps as a reminder to us all of the importance of love, compassion, and an eternal unbroken circle. So on December 24th, 1974, Papa Earl wrote, "We are all well." And by the way, he wrote in shorthand, so pardon, I do extend a couple words. Okay. "We are all well. Temperature approximately 61 degrees. We opened gifts, had lots of fun. I felt very thankful for a best year, 1974, and hope with so many, 1975, to be good. My great wish to all is a fruitful year and good health, and we may all be together next Christmas. We are to have today together. May God guide us all as he sees best, and everything will be all right. Thank you, Father, for the health, warmth, and togetherness. Let us love all, and I feel happiness will prevail as it should." And on that note, thank you all. I am Lindsay Scruggs, and I hope you enjoy the show.
Nobody's fault but mine. Nobody's fault but mine. If I die and my soul be lost, nobody's fault but mine. I hear a mother who could pray. Little birdie, come and sing.
That's Abigail Washburn. In just a few minutes, she gave us the legacy of gospel music and blues and old-time banjo that created key parts of bluegrass music. And one thing I wanted to mention was that the old-time banjo style derived from the way similar instruments were played in West Africa centuries ago, and they made their way through enslaved people to our country, and that downpicking style became the basis of the way banjo was mostly played in our country through the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries up until about 1935, when a young boy named Earl Scruggs adopted that, or came up with a new three-finger style, which we call Scruggs style, and is still played throughout the country and throughout the world, and we thank him for that. Okay, so everybody, welcome to the Station Inn. Oh no, they say that's not right. Let me instead, of course, welcome you to the Ryman Auditorium, the historic home of the Grand Ole Opry. And more importantly, most of all, tonight is a place where we'll be celebrating the 100th anniversary of the birthday of Earl Eugene Scruggs. That's right, the preeminent American musician Earl Scruggs was born on January 6th, 1924, outside Bowling Springs, y'all know where that is, not far from Shelby. He was a brilliant, compassionate, and funny man who many of us gathered here had the privilege to know and even to pick with. My name is Thomas, or Tommy Goldsmith, and I'm a Nashville writer and musician, but I'm a Tar Heel at heart, and that's how I got to know Earl, basically. I'm here at the invitation of Jerry Douglas, the chief organizer of this deal. As you likely know, it's a benefit for the invaluable Earl Scruggs Center in Shelby, which is a home place for Southern stories and Southern music. I'm going to try mostly to keep my mouth shut, because we're really here to listen to music from players like Jerry, Bela Fleck, Allison Brown, Sierra Hall, Sam Bush, the Del McCoury Band, Stuart Duncan, etc. All of them are so highly qualified that I could spend most of tonight listing the various IBMA, CMA, RIAA, ACM, and Grammy Awards they've earned, but I won't. Instead, I think it's safe to say, and this echoes something Jerry said a minute ago, there's probably no one in this room who would be here had it not been for Earl Scruggs. Am I right? Can I get a witness? There's a lot we can say about Earl, but it struck me that he was perhaps a family man most of all. That was true in his Flint Hill homestead with parents George Elam and Lula Root Scruggs, as well as sisters Eula May and Ruby, both strong guitarists, and brothers Junie and Horace, also super musicians. Family life was perhaps even more crucial to Earl when he became husband to the brilliant, influential Louise Scruggs and loving dad to sons Gary, Randy, and Steve, whom we sadly miss. Right now, we've got two outstanding North Carolina pickers, Jim Mills and Brian Sutton, to offer up a couple of tunes that some lucky friends and neighbors might have heard from Earl and Horace in the 30s and early 40s. Earl used to say he didn't get around and play a lot because, you know, we didn't have a car. They would sometimes ride in the wagon to neighbors' houses and play music. But his style got around. One of the tunes we're going to hear, I think the first one, is the tune with which Earl developed his revolutionary style. Please make welcome Brian Sutton and Jim Mills. We're going to move on now to the part of Earl's career where, when he was quite young, his ability and new sound were so striking that he earned attention in regional gigs when he was in his teens and early 20s. In fact, he was only 21 when a recommendation from the fiddler Jim Shoemate got him an audition with the powerful, tall Kentucky singer and mandolin innovator Bill Monroe. I can't stop myself because I grew up watching Harold Hensley and Grant Turner going, getting everybody clapping. So, Bill had been an opera star since 1939 after he broke up with his brother, and we won't go into all that. Bill took only a day or so to decide he needed Earl's style-busting banjo approach to complete what would become the classic sound of what would become bluegrass music. So that it was on December 8, 1945, on this very stage, Earl Scruggs joined Bill Monroe and Lester Flatt for a rare, clearly defined first hearing of an American music style. It was kind of a leap into a new speed, a new dimension of this music that Earl achieved with a banjo, just as Louis Armstrong did with the trumpet, Charlie Parker with the saxophone, Chuck Berry and Jimi Hendrix with the electric guitar, and yes, Jerry Douglas with the resonator guitar. We've got some champion players to do a little role playing of the songs of that classic band. But I did have a thought today about, there's always been a discussion about, well, was Bill the father of bluegrass music? And if so, what role did Earl have? I was thinking, could it be more accurate to say that bluegrass had two dads? Forgive me if you don't believe that way. Anyway, we are bringing forward some great players to portray Lester Flatt, and that would be Dale McCoury singing some lead, and Sam Bush singing some lead. Ronnie McCoury playing mandolin, Jim back again, and Gina Britt playing Earl's part. Stuart Duncan and I believe Jason Carter playing some mandolin. I'm some fiddle, sorry. And Alan Barsham is Howard Watts. And make them welcome. We're also going to have Gina Britt, Rob McCoury, and Allison Brown up here taking part in this great recreation of the Bluegrass Boys. Take her away, boys.
Is that the program?
All right.
That's it.
Thank you.
Good to be out here tonight and good to be celebrating Earl Scruggs. He was the man that got me started back when I was 11 years old. I heard him play the banjo break on Rolling My Sweet Baby's Arms, and I'll tell you what, it just clicked something in my head and it's still going around. But now we'd like to, I guess I'll sing a little number here. Got any folks here from Kentucky? Well, I'd like to try to sing a little tune entitled Blue Moon of Kentucky. Well, you know, I'd like to say this. I used to work for Bill Monroe, you know, back in the early 60s. And, of course, we played this stage here a lot, you know. And Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs at one time worked for Bill Monroe, you know, back in the early days. And they recorded some of these songs. I think Earl and Lester was with Bill Monroe when he recorded this song. Now, I may have to read it off the paper here. Or at least do a few notes off of there. And I don't know if I can read that far. That's pretty far away to read. Right? But I'll sure try. Now, I guess Earl played this, didn't he? Yeah, give me them glasses again there, Sam. This is one, I forget the title. I don't have the title, but I know the words, I think, because they're right there. Goodbye, old pal. Boys. sleeps in perfect peace beneath the Texas sky.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rob McCurry.
Oh yeah, we have another banjo picker out here today. How about Jim Mills and then Stuart Duncan? Those guys. Well, now they're not done working. They're going to be back out here off and on all the night through. And you know, there's a lot of musicians on this show. And like Jerry Douglas said, if it hadn't been for Earl Scruggs, a lot of them wouldn't be here today. I know I probably wouldn't be here. What do you think, Sam?
I think I want to hear you sing another one.
I thought I got a break after that, but I guess I don't.
Not yet.
And what are we going to do anyway? Can you read that?
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, I think I know.
Did you want
to talk to him a little bit?
All I got to say, friends, is if there's a king of bluegrass, oh, sure, his name is Dell. But I grew up in Bowling Green, just north of here, so I got to come down a few times when I was a kid to the Opry. I was sitting right up there one night when I heard not only Bill Monroe, but a couple weeks later heard Flat and Scruggs, and they did this number the night I saw them. So this is wonderful to hear Dell sing it, Little Maggie.
Thank you.
Vilma.
Thank you. Well, I'll tell you what, right now it's time to put Sam to work here. You know, we've done a lot of, me and Sam, we've done a lot of singing together. We went out on the road, you know, we're pretty reckless. We just went out there. One time my manager called me up and said, if you would go out on the road with just one person, who would it be? Who would you like to go out with? And I said, Sam Bush. I did. And guess what? They booked us all over the country. I don't know if it's everywhere, didn't they?
Yeah, we traveled by bus, and before the very first night I wanted, for the very first gig, I got up early. We left Nashville, drive to D.C. I got up early. I want to see what Del McCurry looked like coming out of a bunk. And he walked through the door. His hair was perfect. Exactly like he looks. And I said, Dale, how you do that? How you get up out of the bunk and look like that?
Well, I answered him, you know. I said, well, Sam, you know, I've got a little nightstand back there in the aisleway right beside my bus, and I just reach out and put it on when I get up in the morning.
Oh, yeah. Let's sing, shall we? And, of the great Flat and Scruggs tune, Little Cabin Home on the Hill.
Listen to the rain beat on my window pane in our little cabin home on the hill.
Gina Britt on the five.
Now I'll tell you what, we're going to do a tune here now, and I don't know who, you know, all during the rehearsal, you keep changing instrumental guys and girls, you know, and so I don't know who's picking on this, but I think Jim, how about giving Jim a hand again? Oh, and I don't know if I introduced my son. He was out here on Little Maggie. I was somewhere else on that tune. And is Jason Carter coming out too, is he? Well, they're talking it over now. So this may be something new. Who knows? But I'll tell you what, now, this tune right here, well, the first time I heard it, I said, there ain't a man alive can do that. But he can.
Here's Jim Mills with Dear Old Dixie. On the five.
I don't know. I'll take the last one. Oh, Jim.
Well, you know, I guess it's my turn again. Sam, I thought you was coming up next, but they got you marked off here. Just kidding. But you know, way back, Earl Scruggs was with Bill Monroe, and he took a fine banjo breaks on this tune right here, and it's what Bill Monroe always called the racehorse song, one entitled Molly and Timbers. See the train a-comin', it's comin' round that curve. See old Tim runs
said, Molly, what made your hand so red? From running in the hot sun, a fever in my head. Fever in my head, oh Lord, fever in my head. Out of California, where Mother Nurse she flees. I'm back to old Kentucky, be with all these. Be with all these, oh Lord, be with all these.
It's Allison Brown. We got just another to two on this segment, and thank you for being here tonight in honor of Earl Scruggs.
Thank you. Thank you, folks. Yes, appreciate it.
Here's a tune that, again, Bill and Earl and Lester and Chubby Wise played this one. This was about... when the bluegrass boys will get done on Saturday night, it's time to go on the road. They load up from here and get with it. And so this chronicles the tales of traveling in the bluegrass boys. Heavy traffic ahead. Thank you.
town, there's heavy traffic ahead.
Bill McCurry, Sam Bush, Jim Bill, Alan Barton, Stuart Duncan, and Jason Carter. All right, it takes you right on back, doesn't it? I don't know about y'all, but I noticed a little competition among them players. That's something that Earl used to talk about. He thought Monroe was somebody you could really push against, and Bill would push back at you in playing. And man, I saw them on this stage, I think in the 80s, they were playing with Scaggs. And somebody said they went up to the dressing room, and Earl looked like he was about half asleep, and Bill was kind of not paying a lot of attention. When they came down here and got on stage, man, it was 170 beats per minute, if it was anything. Playing one of the Earl's tunes. Anyway, this music is not easy to play. Any of y'all who have tried to play the five-string banjo like Earl or the mandolin like Bill will can attest to that. It's fiendishly difficult, in fact, especially to play it with a lot of feeling and expression in the way that Earl did. But once Monroe's band got going and bluegrass continued to expand, it was sparked by Bill's records on Columbia and Decca, those 78s with Earl and Lester and Chubby Wise and whoever was in the band early on like that. And people started trying to play it. And there was no, you know, there was no internet. There was no, some of the guys would slow the records down and try to learn it that way. But before very long at all, there were players like Ralph Stanley. Yeah. And Sonny Osborne. And Don Reno, and don't argue with me about Don Reno and Three Finger Style. J.D. Crow. And Rudy Lyle, an underappreciated player. And there were guys, not in every community, but enough of them to where bluegrass bands started forming. And they always featured the Three Finger Style that Earl had pioneered just a few years earlier. And through the years, and really fairly early on, I discovered Roger Sprung was teaching five-string banjo in New York City in 48 or something. So there were a lot of people who took on that role. They were all musicians as well. And one of the best, I hear him tinkling on the banjo back there, I believe, was Mr. Tony Trischka. So let's bring him out here. I believe he's got Michael Cleveland, Ronnie McCrory, Todd Phillips, and Dale McCrory with him.
Thank you. I'm going to do three tunes that are taken from these jam sessions that Earl did with John Hartford somewhere in the mid, between the, yeah, John Hartford, absolutely. And they did all sorts of unexpected things, including Here Comes the Bride. Truly, truly. Anyway, I put together an album which will be coming out in May of 15 of these tunes, one of which I'm going to play for you right now. Did you get this one? Thank you, Jerry. Is my collar okay? Anyway, I mean, one of the tunes that Earl played was just a solo tune, and it's kind of a really rare thing. He's talking to John in these jam session. In this jam session, he says, "Here's a tune I would play when I was a kid for square dances when there was no one else to play, no other instruments." And so it's kind of a solo banjo thing, and it's of historical import. Easy for me to say, because it's like some of the earliest example of Earl playing besides Reuben. So this is called "Shout Little Lulu."
Okay.
Like to bring out the band right now and do a tune that's also going to be on the album. And what's really fun is we got to rehearse yesterday morning at 10 a.m. and this is, you know, just an incredible band and such a great way to start the day. So we're hiring out the band for wake-up calls instead of your alarm clock, so at a nominal fee. Yeah, you know these folks, they've already been out here, but and we're going to do a tune called Brown's Ferry Blues.
Woman, and now he's down. Lord, Lord, got them Brown's Ferry Blues. Hard life, how about getting too tired? If you don't quit drinking, he'll be high as a kite. Lord, Lord, got them Brown's Ferry Blues. Walk a rock and tackle a line. Lord, Lord, I got them Brown's Ferry Blues. Well, I walked up to my girl's old man and asked him for my true love's hand. Lord, Lord, I got them Brown's Ferry. Set of her hand, I got his foot. Lord, Lord, I got them Brown's Ferry Blues. Mm-hmm. couldn't buy no grain.
Lord, Lord, I got them Browns fairy blue. Again. Lord, Lord, I got them Browns fairy blue.
Well, he took my sweetheart with him too, 'cause she had a little drink or two.
Lord, Lord, I got them Browns fairy blue.
We're going to add Jason Carter on this. He can't be two fiddles. No way.
Uh-oh.
And we're going to feature a doll on a tune that he recorded with Bill Monroe back in 1963. And he's singing it just as well, if not better. Roll on, Buddy.
Oh, it's already been introduced. Sorry.
Tony Trischka and an all-star assemblage there. We have a special treat for you now, as if all of these have not been special so far. I would like to thank or mention that we are doing this for the benefit of the Earl Scruggs Center in Shelby. If you hadn't been there, you need to go. And I'd like to thank Jerry Douglas for setting this whole thing up and putting a lot of energy into it. Now, I'm going to have an assistant because I'm wearing out a little bit. This is a great segment that gets back to the roots of bluegrass music, just as Ms. Washburn's did. And if you lean back in history to the great days of Flat and Scruggs in the 60s when they were making these huge hit albums, they had one, I believe it was called Live at Carnegie Hall. And we brought up a feller here, I think you may know him by a different name, but we're going to call him Lester tonight. And he's going to explain to you what we're fixing to do with a series of duets that formed a band at one time. And that was true for many years in the Southeast particularly. But Lester, you think you can come up and give us a rendering of what these are going to be about?
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much, Tommy. Oh, thank you. Thank you very much. Down in our part of the country, hadn't been too many years ago since just a five-string banjo and a fiddle was kindly called a band back in them days. When they mentioned a band, one would reach and get the fiddle and the other in a banjo. And they had it all ready to go. So we'd like for the banjos and the fiddles to come out here and kindly show y'all what it's all about here tonight. You boys ready out there?
Sure.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, all right. Was that not the coolest thing you have ever heard? The Fiddle and Banjo Suite. There's so many fiddlers and banjo players, I can't name them all. We are going to take a short break. We'll be right back, and there is a whole lot of good music to come. Thank you for being here.
I'm in and going back to
Houston, Houston, Houston.
Got a girl waiting there for me. At least she said she'd be. I got a home and a good warm bed and a feather pillow for my head. I'm going back to
Houston, Houston, Houston.
Well, it's lonesome in this old town. Everybody puts me down. I'm a face without a name. Just a walking in the rain. Going back to
Houston, Houston, Houston.